Hi, everybody. I know it's Thanksgiving weekend. A lot of people are still out. They're still visiting family or driving back today or whatever. But I thank you all for coming. Or I guess I could. I thank y'all for coming. You all. Y'all. Still can't pull it off. I'll work on it. So, all right. So, hey, thank you. Good morning, First Christian Church. Hopefully, when you walked in, you grabbed one of the bulletins. If you look on the back, you're going to see we have quite a few announcements. One of the ones that, of course, immediately after the service this morning, we are having our board meeting. So hopefully you can stay for that. Also, there's going to be no Sunday evening Bible study. Remember that, because there's going to be no Sunday evening Bible study next week as well. From what I understand, the choir is still practicing. The choir is still meeting. So you guys are going to be doing that. There will not be a Sunday school class this next Sunday as well for next Sunday. All right? So no Sunday school class that I'm teaching, no Sunday evening. But make sure that you guys come. All right? Not to the Sunday school class, because you'll be sitting in there all by yourself. But make sure Sunday night, the Bible study, because you'll be sitting in there all by yourself. But other than that, come, all right? The youth are collecting items to make families of hospice care baskets to be delivered to the Baptist Hospital. These baskets will be available for people who have family members on the hospice floor. A list of items is located in the foyer, and all items need to be in by Sunday, December 18th, if you would like to donate. Also, December 16th at 6, bring the kids. Bring the grandkids. It is going to be our happy birthday Jesus. All right. So there's going to be cake and ice cream, as well as a letter writing station, picture backdrop, etc. That's going to be fun. All right. So that is all of the announcements that we are having this morning. So if you would please stand as we sing the first song, Nothing But the Blood.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Well, this morning, as we come around the table, I'm just going to ask, let's remember the purpose and what Jesus had told his disciples at the Last Supper. The bread is Jesus' body, and the wine was the blood that was shed for us. So as we partake, let's think about that and make sure we've got our hearts with Jesus. Put out all the worldly worries of the day. Put aside any frustrations you might have, because we are in the house of God. Right now, we are safe from whatever Satan is throwing at us if we'll keep our mind on Jesus. Let's pray. Most gracious and kind Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to come around your table. And we ask you, Lord, to guide our hearts and our minds so that we can truly understand the meaning of the bread and the wine and what it means to us in each and everything that we do. And Lord, then guide us so that we can go out into the world and not just tell people, but show them the love of Jesus through our actions. This rest in the name of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Emblems are at the back. Oh, partake as you wish.
journey of going through life, and you start off and you accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and you want to grow closer, you want to be found in Him, you realize early on, hopefully, when you surrender, that all we need is Jesus. It doesn't matter what stage in life you're in, all we need is Jesus. Because He is the one who saves.
In the morning, when I rise, in the morning, when I rise, in the morning, when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, just give me Jesus. When I am alone, when I am alone, oh, when I am alone, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, just give me
His name because of what He has done. Thank you, Jesus, for dying on the cross for us. It's in Your name we pray. Amen. Say, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Why? Because He is the only God.
not a God created by human hands. You are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything we can give by your plan. That's just the way it is.
Go up to Ohio for a few days to spend time with family, Thanksgiving. But before we left, Heather went shopping at Walmart. And so she got some stuff, and Tuesday night we were about ready to leave, and she's over at the island in the kitchen, and she goes, "Oh, don't you like these flowers?" And she goes, "I got them at, they were on the sale items over at Walmart." And I looked at them and I said, "I didn't even know you bought flowers." And there they were, right there in the kitchen. And she was like, "God, typical, you know?" But on the way up there, on the way up to Ohio, we're driving, I'm looking, and I point out into this field way far away, and she's like, "What, what?" And I said, "Look, there's a deer way out there, you know?" And then she goes, "You can see a deer 500 yards away, but you can't see a pot of flowers on the kitchen table?" And I go, "Nope, I guess not." So So then on the way up there, as we were driving, we were north of Nashville, and we were moving. I mean, we were driving, and I punched it to pass some people, and the engine started to shake. Not good. I back off, and we're driving, and then I start to pass again, and the engine is starting to shake. And then we're driving, and we got hours and hours to go. And I'm like, well, maybe it's only at really high speeds. If you're just regular driving and not flooring it, you were fine. But the moment that you were aggressive with the engine, the whole thing is shaking. So we get off of the highway, off of 71. We're turning towards where we needed to go, and Brandon, who's sitting back there with Cameron, by the way, they were in the car behind us. Don't put your head down, Brandon. Everybody's looking at you. Don't worry about it. So I stopped and I said, well, let me just see if it does it at low speeds. So I put it in sport mode, which, you know, for a pickup truck, that's really fast. So I put it in sport mode, and at the stop sign when we were turning right, I floored it. And that engine is just, I was like, oh, what did I do? So the next day, talking with Chris, and of course, I forgot that Brandon went to EMCC and he's a mechanic. Huh? North, okay, fine. He went to Northeast. So anyway, but he's got his degree, and I said to Chris, who works on cars, I said, yeah, it's doing this, and they're like, well, it's probably a coil. So we replaced the coil, and it works just fine now. So thankfully, only $80 in, and the truck is fixed. So we're good. So on the way home, I'm testing it at low speed, high speed, making sure that the engine doesn't, and it was doing just fine. So we were excited to come home. My truck is fixed. We're doing well. We pull out of Alabama, and we're in Mississippi, and we're on the other side of Aberdeen, and I turn left to go towards Aberdeen, actually, and we had to slow down because right in the middle of the road was a pot-bellied pig. Huge, huge pig just walking in the street in front of the house that they were in. I said, only when we get back in Mississippi did I have to worry about hitting a pig. But we did, so we got it, so we're good. All right, so hopefully you read your Bibles this week. Hopefully you read in the book of Ezra. So that is where we are going to be in today, Ezra. So as you go back and you look at this, if you've been following along and on what's been happening, we've come to the point where we've gone through Judges where the people were following God, not following God. They wanted a king, so they got King Saul. King Saul didn't work out, so they got King David. And then after King David, they had Solomon. Solomon built the temple. And after they built the temple, they were worshiping God there. And then they had other kings. Some would follow God. Some of them wouldn't. So it was back and forth. Prophets were coming, saying, please stop doing these things because you're going to be taken away, you're going to be destroyed, you're going to be killed, all these things, and they just wouldn't listen. So finally, King Nebuchadnezzar comes in, destroys Jerusalem, destroys the temple, destroys the buildings, destroys everything, and takes them away for 70 years. Now we fast forwarded 70 years, and the people have decided that it's time for them to go back home. So they ask the king, can we go home? He said, yes. Give you everything you need to go back home. Now we're in Ezra where we're learning about them rebuilding the temple. So look at chapter 3. Chapter 3 starts this. When the seventh month came and the Israelites had settled in their towns, the people assembled together as one. One. It's kind of hard to assemble and accomplish something when you're divided. They've been in exile for 70 years, and they come together as one. They came together as one in Jerusalem. Then Joshua, son of Jozadak, and his fellow priests, and Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, and his associates began to build the altar of the God of Israel to sacrifice burnt offerings on it, in accordance with what was written in the law of Moses, the man of God. Despite their fear of the peoples around them, they built the altar on its foundation and sacrificed burnt offerings on it to the Lord, both the morning and evening sacrifices. So they were afraid of who? The people. Where? The people around them. They weren't afraid of their people. They were afraid of the people who had settled or resettled into Jerusalem that were living around them. They were not afraid of their God who was sending them back home. They weren't afraid of the sacrifices or building the altar or doing those. They were afraid of the people. Because when they're not happy with you, you know that the outside world is not happy with you. But the people were afraid of them. No. See, guys, the world is not happy with us. Not happy with this book. Not happy with the rules and the regulations and the decrees and all these things and the ordinances and everything that God has established for us. I'm not afraid of him. I'm not afraid of you. And I am not afraid of them out there. Neither should you. Because we've even learned in Ephesians that the fight is not with the people, but it's with the spirit fights, the spiritual warfare that's going on. That's where the real battle is. It's not out there. And it really isn't in here. And he goes on. Verse 4. Then, in accordance with what was written, they celebrated the Feast of the Tabernacles with the required number of burnt offerings prescribed for each day. After that, they presented the regular burnt offerings, the new moon sacrifice, and all their sacrifices for all the appointed sacred festivals of the Lord, as well as those brought as freewill offerings to the Lord. On the first day of the seventh month, they began to offer burnt offerings to the Lord, though the foundation of the temple, the Lord's temple, had not yet been laid. Then they gave money to the masons and the carpenters and gave food and drink and olive oil to the people of Sidon and Tyre so that they would bring cedar logs by sea from Lebanon to Joppa authorized by Cyrus, king of Persia. Now remember that. Here was their king back in Babylonia that they went to and they said, hey, he saw his cupbearer actually. And he goes, hey, you seem kind of down. What's going on? Oh, we're from Jerusalem. We're from Israel. I kind of want to go back and take a look at my old city and my old temple. Can I go? Sure, go. So he goes back and he looks and he sees it just completely destroyed. And he comes back and he says to him, he goes, hey, the king says, hey, King Cyrus, hey, what's, you still look upset? Well, it's completely destroyed. Nebuchadnezzar completely destroyed everything. There's nothing left. I'd really like for me to go back and rebuild everything. And King Cyrus said, tell you what, I'll write you letters. You and your people, why don't you go back to your home city? And all the things that were taken from you, King Nebuchadnezzar, what he gave, what he took from you, I'm going to give back. And honestly, you know what else? To help you get back on your feet, to rebuild your city, to rebuild the temple to your God, we're going to supply all the gold that you need and all the silver and all the good. And take everything. Rebuild it. Go back to where you need to go. King Cyrus is like, yes, go and be and worship your God. Then he goes on and says this. And in the second month of the second year at their annual arrival at the house of God in Jerusalem, Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, Joshua, son of Jozadak, and the rest of the people, the priests and the Levites, and all who had returned from their captivity in Jerusalem, began the work. They appointed Levites 20 years old in order to supervise the building of the house of the Lord. Joshua and his sons and the brothers and Kadmiel and his sons, the descendants of Hodaviah, and the sons of Henadad and their sons and their brothers, all the Levites joined together in supervising those working on the house of God. When the builders laid the foundation of the temple of the Lord, the priests in their vestments and with the trumpets and the Levites, the sons of Asaph and their cymbals took their places with pride to praise the Lord as prescribed by King David, king of Israel. With praise and thanksgiving, they sang to the Lord. He is good. His love towards Israel endures forever. Look on the screen. Do you remember last week? What happened last week when we were reading? They built it. They built the temple. And everybody came together and they were playing their instruments. And they were marching and they were singing. His love endures forever. And now, 70 years after being exiled, coming back, and they've laid the foundation, and they're singing again, his love endures forever. Do you remember? Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Sing praise, right? And I told you, when you are in church, when you are sitting in the pew, it's not about who's sitting around you. It's not about who's sitting in front of you. It's not about who's singing behind you or sitting beside you. It is between you and him. When we come together on Sundays, it's between you and him. And these people all got together. The foundation was laid. And the people saying, he is good. His love endures forever. Look at what's next. And all the people gave a great shout of praise to the Lord because the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid. And all the people gave a great what? And all the people gave a great shouted to God. Most of the time, we're too embarrassed to even sing. Someone might hear us. Do you know what? Do you know how many times I practiced that song that we did, the first song for the opening of the service? Do you know why? Because we didn't have the person singing it that normally sings it, which is the recording artist. I did. Do you know how many times I practiced? I didn't want to embarrass myself in front of you guys. And I might have still embarrassed myself in front of you guys by singing it without the artist there. And that's okay, because I was singing it not for you. I was singing it for him. Verse 12. But many of the older priests and the Levites and the family heads who had seen the former temple wept aloud because the foundation of the temple was laid, while many others shouted for joy. No one could distinguish the sound of the joys, shouts of joy and the sound of the weeping, because the people made so much noise, and the sound was heard far away. And the people did what? Shouted! They shouted to the Lord. Woo! This is great. We laid the foundation of the temple, and the people were shouting, and other people were weeping, and it was heard from so far away. What's that? Did you guys hear that noise? I'll tell you what. You probably heard that noise. You're not going to believe it. It's just this church in the middle of downtown West Point called First Christian. And when they get together and they start singing, they are so loud. And you can hear it up and down the streets. It's amazing. Did you hear that shout? It's because the people are just worshiping God. And it doesn't, and they just let everybody know that they're worshiping God. And it's, you heard them? Yeah, we hear them up and down the street all the time on Sundays, because they're just praising God and worshiping Him. And if, I can't believe you never heard them before, because every Sunday they're just singing so loud. Because they don't care what people on the streets think. They don't care with the people around them in their pews, because from what I understand, it's not about them, it's about God. The people weep because they remember what it was like, the foundation of the temple 70 years ago before it was destroyed. And the new people who were there were shouting for praise because they've heard stories about the temple. They've heard all these amazing things that happened at the temple. And they were singing praise. And the older people were weeping. And it just was so much. And it was amazing. And then chapter 4. When the enemies of Judah and Benjamin heard that the exiles were building the temple of the Lord, the God of Israel, they came to Zerubbabel and the heads of the families and said, "Let us help you build, because like you, we seek your God and have been sacrificing to him since the time of Esarhaddon, king of Assyria, who brought us here." But Zerubbabel, Joshua, and the rest of the heads of the families of Israel answered, "You have no part of us in building the temple of our God. We alone will build it for our Lord, the God of Israel, as King Cyrus, the king of Persia, commanded us." But we want to help you. We're just like you. And we want to worship your God. We want to worship with you. We want to help you build your temple so that we can all worship together. No. You're not a part of this family. You got to protect the flock. You got to protect the family. But we want to worship with you. Uh-uh. No. You got to protect the family. And he goes on. Then the people around them set out to discourage the people of Judah and to make them afraid to go on building. They bribed officials to work against them and frustrated their plans during the entire reign of Cyrus, king of Persia, and down to the reign of Darius, king of Persia. So now we've gone through Cyrus and to Darius kings. How long does it take you to build a temple? Long time. Long time. So we've gone through Cyrus and we've gone through Darius. And at the beginning of the reign of who? Xerxes! Huh? Sunday school class. We've been learning about Xerxes in the book of Esther. Here he is again. At the beginning of the reign of Xerxes, they lodge an accusation against the people of Judah and Jerusalem. And in the days of Artaxerxes, king of Persia, Bishlam, Mithrath, Tabeel, and the rest of the associates wrote a letter to Artaxerxes. The letter was written in Aramaic script and in Aramaic language. So then we went to Xerxes, and now we're in Artaxerxes. Rehum, the commanding officer, and Shimshai, the secretary, wrote a letter against Jerusalem to Artaxerxes, and the king as follows. Rehum, the commanding officials, and Shimshai, the secretary, together with all the rest of the associates, the judges, the officials, and administrators over the people of Persia, Uruk, and Babylon, and Elamites, as Susa, and the other people whom the great and honorable Ashurbanipal imported and settled in the city of Samaria and elsewhere in Trans-Euphrates. This is the copy of the letter that they sent to him. To King Artaxerxes, from your servants in Trans-Euphrates, the king should know that the people who came up to us from you have gone to Jerusalem and are rebuilding the rebellious and wicked city. They are restoring the walls and repairing the foundations. Furthermore, the king should know that if the city is built and its walls are restored, no more taxes, tribute, or duty will be paid, and eventually the royal revenues will suffer. Now, since we are under obligation to the palace and it is not proper for us to see the king dishonored, we are sending this message to inform the king so that a search may be made in the archives of your predecessors. In these records, you will find that the city is a rebellious city, troublesome to the kings and provinces, a place that has a long history of sedition. That is why the city was destroyed. We inform the king that this city is built and its walls are restored. You will be left with nothing in the Trans-Euphrates. The king sent this reply to Rehum, the commanding officers, Shimshai, the secretary, and the rest of their associates living in Samaria and elsewhere in Trans-Euphrates. Greetings. The letter you sent us has been read and translated in my presence. I issued an order and a search was made, and this found that the city has a long history of revolt against kings and has been a place of rebellion and sedition. Jerusalem has had powerful kings ruling over the whole Trans-Euphrates, and taxes, tribute, and duty were paid to them. Now issue an order to these men to stop work so that the city may not be rebuilt until I so order. Be careful not to neglect this matter. Why let this threat grow and to the detriment of the royal interests? As soon as the copy of the letter from Artaxerxes was read in Rehum, in Shimshai, the secretary, and their associates, they went immediate to the Jews in Jerusalem and compelled them by force to stop. Thus the work of the house of God in Jerusalem came to a standstill until the second year of the reign of Darius, king of Persia. Go to chapter 6. So then they went and they wrote a letter to Darius. Hey, need you to do us a favor. Go back and look in the records and see what was said about us from Cyrus and what the law was that was issued for us. And he went back and he did. And they found the records, the minutes of that meeting, of that conversation, and all that was done. And then for chapter 6, it says this: King Darius and issued an order, and they searched for the archives stored in the treasury of Babylon. A scroll was found in the citadel of Ecbatana in the province of Media, and that was written on it. Memorandum: in the first year of King Cyrus, the king issued a decree concerning the temple of God in Jerusalem. Let the temple be rebuilt as a place to present sacrifices, and let its foundations be laid. It is to be 60 cubits high and 60 cubits wide, and 3 courses of large stone and 1 of timbers. The costs are to be paid by the royal treasury. Also, the gold and the silver articles of the house of God, which Nebuchadnezzar took from the temple in Jerusalem and brought to Babylon, are to be returned to the places in the temple of Jerusalem, so that they are to be deposited in the house of God. Now then, Tatanai, governor of Trans-Euphrates, and Shethabozai and you other officials in the province, stay away from there. Do not interfere with the work of the temple of God. Let the governor of the Jews, let the Jewish leaders rebuild this house of God on its site. Therefore, I hereby decree that you are to do these, you are to do for these elders of the Jews in the construction of the house of God. He says it's going to be okay. It's in the records. Don't get in their way. His love endures forever. Let it be built. Get out of their way. When you do what he wants you to do, and he has the plans to let you succeed, nothing can stop us. Verse 13. Then because of the decree King Darius had sent, Tattenai, governor of the Trans-Euphrates, and Shethabozai and his associates carried out with diligence. So the elders of the Jews continued to build and prosper under the preaching of Haggai the prophet, Zechariah, a descendant of Iddo. They finished building the temple according to the command of the God of Israel and the decree of Cyrus, Darius, Artaxerxes, kings of Persia. The temple was completed on the third day of the month of Adar, in the sixth year of the reign of King Darius. Then the people of Israel, the priests, the Levites, and the rest of the exiles celebrated the dedication of the house of God with joy. With what? Joy. It's done. We get to worship again the God of this temple, our God. It's done. It's amazing. The whole thing is built and we get to go and worship and do these things. It's done. So all the people got to shout out for joy. And they got to sing out loud, his love endures forever. And they got to offer the sacrifices to him there. And on the 14th day of the first month, the exiles celebrated the Passover. The priests and the Levites had purified themselves and were all ceremonially clean. The Levites slaughtered the Passover lamb for all the exiles, other relatives of the priests, and for themselves. So the Israelites, who had returned from the exile, ate it, together with all who had separated themselves from the unclean practices of the Gentile neighbors, in order to seek the Lord, the God of Israel. For 7 days, they celebrated with joy the festival of unleavened bread, because the Lord had filled them with joy by changing the attitude of the king of Assyria so that he assisted them in their work in the house of God, the God of Israel. His love endures forever. Did you see there was that word in there again? He filled them with joy. I wonder what needs to change, happen. For us all to be filled with that joy. of us to have the impact in the community that they did. For us to move forward. And when you come into church on Sundays, you're joyous. It's Sunday morning. We get to go to church today. Woo! I don't know how many times we watched Elf over the last couple days. There is a young man sitting in the back pew next to my daughter who had never seen the movie before. Never seen it before. So we wanted to watch it. So he wanted to see it. Do you remember when he goes to Gimbel's the first time? And the guy is like, I got an announcement to make, right? 9 a.m., Santa's coming, be here. And all of a sudden, buddy, do you remember what he does? Santa! Santa's coming! Santa's coming! Santa's coming! Oh, I know him, right? I know him! Santa's coming! Eric's leading the songs. Can't sing a key. All right, we'll go. All right. Get in the car. It's Sunday! We get to come to worship him. He changes us. We impact the community. You may not like it, but it's not about you. It's about him. Let's pray. Thank you.